your God. Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the name.
Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which had not been told them they shall see, and that which they had not heard they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with an infirmity. And as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that is before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish we shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Because he poured himself out to death, and was numbered with the transgressors, yet he bore the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray Psalm 22 responsibly by whole verse. My God, why have you forsaken me, and are so far from my cry and from the words of my distress?
O my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not answer. By night as well, but I find no rest.
Yet you are the Holy One, enthroned upon the praises of Israel.
Our forefathers put their trust in you. They trusted and you delivered them.
They cried out to you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not put to shame.
As for me, I am born and known.
shall be known as the Lord's forever.
It shall come and be known to the people yet evermore, the saving deeds that he has done.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus Christ according to John.
Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priest and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Who are you looking for?" They answered,
"Jesus,
my master." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said,
"Jesus, my master."
Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's leg, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malichus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the religious authorities arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took to him to Ananias, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas. Then the high priest that ruled, the high priest that year, Caiaphas, who was the one who advised them, said it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest, but Peter was standing outside of the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who was guarded at the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You are not also one of the man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter was also standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple where all believers came together. I have nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said this to them, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Ananias sent him back to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him,
"You are not also one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment, the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning that they themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusations do you bring against this man?" They answered,
"If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you."
Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The leaders replied,
"We are not permitted to put anyone to death."
This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die.
Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the people. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the people again and told them, "I find no case against him. But you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" They shouted in reply,
"Not this man, but Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged, and the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews,"
and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him." The people answered him,
"We have a law, and according to that law, we ought to die, because he has claimed to be the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the mob cried out,
"If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. For anyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Golgotha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Judean leaders, "Here is your king." They cried out,
"Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!"
Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but the emperor."
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus and carried the cross by himself. He went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the people read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priest said to Pilate,
"Do not write the King of the Jews, for this man said, I am the King of the Jews."
Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another,
"Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it."
This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciples whom he loved standing beside beside her and said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the people did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. They asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified man broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified, so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled: "None of his bones shall be broken." And again, another passage of scripture says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced." After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
Thank you.
Christ Jesus. Amen. Holy Week is all about immersing ourselves in the stories from Jerusalem roughly 2,000 years ago. On Palm Sunday, we heard about Jesus walking down the Mount of Olives and through Jerusalem. For the rest of the week, we hold these words of Scripture in our hearts so that as we examine and experience the people and the world around us, we keep asking, whose restoration and wholeness do we envision in the kingdom of God? What does that look and sound like? Last night, having washed each other's feet, or having watched others, people engage in the practice of holy foot washing, we ended the service by watching the altar and this whole area being stripped bare. The final commandment of Jesus rings in our ears as we sit and watch with him, as we get into our cars and back. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. And tonight, we sit at the foot of the cross. Sitting at the foot of the cross reminds us that grief is holy. In the Episcopal Church, funerals are Easter services. It reminds us that just as Jesus was raised from the dead, the person who died shall also be raised. And believing in resurrection doesn't mean that there is nothing to feel sad about. This doesn't mean that our grief is unchristian. Our grief is a reflection of our gratitude for having had that person in our lives. Our sorrow is an extension of the love that still connects us, though they are on the other side of the veil. I often hear people talk about getting through grief. Grief isn't something we can check off the list and call it done. I've heard it said that grief is like a wave. It may be big or small, rhythmic or unpredictable. Imagine trying to pack a wave in a box. Just keep seeping through or spewing out, and soon we run out of hands to try to keep it all in. Jesus suffered grief on the cross. Tonight we heard echoes of his last words on the cross, as recorded in the Gospel according to Mark. My God, why have you forsaken me? As some have pointed out, this verse is a reference to Psalm 22. Ends on a more hopeful note. So maybe there is more hope in these words, too. And while that upswing may be in the back of your mind for the writers and the listeners, at this moment, that is not their focus. They are fully feeling the weight of the sense of alienation and abandonment. They don't gloss over the hurt by saying, well, this is part of God's plan. They don't try to justify the pain by saying, God doesn't give us anything we can't handle. Through the reading of the Passion, we acknowledge that grief is heavy and it is hard. It is holy, but not because God created it to test us. It is holy because God set aside God's self to experience what we humans do. To experience what we humans do to each other, what we humans do to ourselves. It is good, but not because it's part of God's high-intensity interval training plan to develop our spiritual muscles and emotional endurance. It is good because it encourages us to strip away our protective and defensive layers, and become vulnerable and honest so that we can see where the hurt is really coming from. When we grieve, we take the first steps toward healing. Tonight, we sit at the foot of the cross. Sitting at the foot of the cross reminds us that we can't afford to look away. Crucifixion crucifixion wasn't a special method of torture the Romans invented for Jesus. This was common punishment for slaves and bandits and rebels. They did this to make a point, to impose order and maintain control. They left up the vertical beams as an implicit and explicit threat to anyone who even thought about upsetting the balance of power. Clearly, this didn't work out the way they hoped, because they had to keep crucifying people. Jesus wasn't the first, nor was he the last. The people who followed in his footsteps continued to take up that crossbeam, that yoke. We don't keep our eyes on the cross because we want to suffer or because we want to die on the cross, as he did. That's not why we take up the yoke either. We do it because we want to love, as he did. We do it because we want to live for something. We want our lives to stand for something. We seek to empty ourselves of the worldly illusions of power and authority, as he did. We recognize that imposing order through force or violence isn't ever going to fix brokenness. That will simply perpetuate and or transfer the cycles of trauma brokenness. We recognize that imposing order by taking away freedom isn't ever going to make us whole, as individuals or as a people. It means innocent people will keep being crucified, being lynched and locked away and killed in the name of our safety and security. When we are honest and open about what's not working, what hasn't been working, we take the first steps toward wholeness. Tonight, we sit at the foot of the cross. Sitting at the foot of the cross reminds us to lean into the mystery of salvation. Some people focus on the mechanics of salvation. Too often the story is told that humans sinned so that God had to sacrifice God's only Son to pay the price that God demanded. This is an attempt to work out the logic of how Jesus, minus life, eternal life, for all those who have died, are dying, and will never die. Some people focus on the mathematics of salvation. Their goal is to figure out the point system assigned to sin and good deeds, confession and forgiveness, and the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. This way, they know what they hold in them. And the downside is that some people who go through life with this framework will try to game the system, try to find the loophole. Some people will focus on telling other people what they need to do instead of looking in the mirror. And rather than figuring out the mechanics or the mathematics, perhaps tonight is a night we give ourselves over to mystery. This is where God comes in. In the Gospel according to John, Jesus' final words are, "It is finished." He has done everything that is humanly possible to do, and now it is up to God. We don't earn salvation by being effective or efficient. We don't work our way to salvation by implementing best practices or hunting for the most helpful continuing ed classes. We don't qualify for salvation by reading a certain number of books or offering more help to others than we are willing to accept for ourselves. Salvation is already ours, and the road to salvation goes through the cross. When Christians talk about the Easter people, the focus is on resurrection. We jump ahead to living a new and shining life in Christ, but the road to Easter goes through Good Friday. If we are going to be Easter people, perhaps we need to be Good Friday people. So, we lament. We feel the full weight of our grief for ourselves, our loved ones, and the world. So, we let go. We examine and embrace the brokenness of the world so we can move toward restoration. So, live in this in-between place where we surrender everything to God and seek to respond to God's gifts of grace and love, where we accept that we are children of God and recognize that we aren't God, and where we lay down our burdens and take up the yoke of Christ. Tonight, we sit at the foot of the cross. Thanks be to God. Standing or kneeling, let us pray together the song calls. Dear people of God, God sent the Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved, that we might be delivered from the power of sin and death, and become heirs with him of everlasting life. We pray, therefore, for people everywhere according to their needs.
Let us pray for the Church of God throughout the world, for unity in witness and service, for all disciples of Christ and whom they serve, for Andy, our bishop, and all the people of this diocese, for all Christians in this place, for those awaiting the outward signs and grace of baptism, particularly Stella and Cole, for those who are mocked and persecuted for their faith, that God will confirm the church in faith, increase it in love, and preserve it in peace.
Compassionate and ever merciful God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, hear our prayer which we offer for all your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry each may serve you in love and truth to the glory of your name, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us pray for all creation, for the fragility, the interdependence, for the majesty and wonder, for the creatures and plants, for the urgency of our call to active, loving stewardship.
Most loving God, you breathe life into all creation and call it good. Move us to live lightly and tread gently upon this earth, resisting the temptations of consumerism and waste, of destruction and pollution, that we may participate in the healing, renewal, and liberation of your creation. Amen.
Let us pray for all nations and peoples of the earth, and for those in authority among them, for Joseph, the President of the United States, for the Congress and the Supreme Court, for the members and representatives of the United Nations, for all who serve the common good, that by God's help, they may seek justice and truth and live in peace and concord.
Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of peace, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that in tranquility your dominion may increase, until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for the practitioners of every faith, for the Jewish people first to hear God's word, and bearers of an eternal covenant, for Muslims, faithful offspring of Abraham and exemplars of mercy, for those who follow the noble eightfold path of the Buddha, for those who witness to different aspects of God from where they stand, that God will preserve each from malice and harm, stir us to mutual understanding, and forge new pathways to justice and healing.
Holy God, you are the source and ground of all being. Guide people of every faith to affirm your wisdom within and beyond their traditions. Unite people of many faiths in bonds of love and mutual respect, that together we may hasten the coming of a holy peace.
Amen.
Let us pray for all who suffer, who are afflicted in body or in mind, for those who are hungry or homeless, destitute or oppressed, for those who are sick or wounded, for those who live with loneliness, fear, or anguish, for those who face temptation, loss of faith, or despair, for those who know sorrow or grief, for prisoners, refugees, and captives, for victims of war, genocide, and trafficking, and all those in mortal danger, that God's mercy will comfort and relieve with mercy and reveal divine love, and stir up in us the will and patience to minister to their needs.
required those in misery and need to come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions. And give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for those who have not received the goodness of God, for those who have lost their faith, for those who bring contempt or scorn, for any whose faith leads to persecution, violence, or hatred, that God will open all hearts to truth and lead each in paths of conscience and goodwill.
Merciful God, you care for all the peoples of the earth. Deepen our compassion and strengthen our resolve that by your promised Holy Spirit, we may meet violence, persecution, contempt, and scorn with great love.
Amen.
Let us commit ourselves to our God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all God's children who have departed this world, those who have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection.
O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
We glory in your cross, O Lord.
We praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For by virtue of your cross, the glorious Son of the whole world.
May God be merciful to us and bless us. Show us the light of his countenance and
let your ways be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
We glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For by virtue of your cross, joy is found to the whole world.
Let us pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, we pray you to set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment and our souls, now and in the hour of our death. Give mercy and grace to the living, pardon and rest to the dead, and to your holy church peace and concord, and to us sinners everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and Holy Spirit, you live and reign, one God,